Thank you. That was just beautiful, wasn't it? Yes. So good morning. Welcome to worship. I'm so glad that you can all be here with me, and to you who are joining us virtually, we are happy that you can be with us too, and we invite you to come in person. You maybe have pretty good cookies at your place, but we got better back here. A special welcome to friends and family who may be with us this weekend. Please stay for coffee afterwards so we can get to know you. The flowers you will see around the sanctuary are from Gloria Brockman's funeral Friday morning. Thank you to all who served that funeral in any way. This is truly sacred ground that we walk on when we walk with families through loss, and it is so, so appreciated. Our sympathy to Bob and to Dan and to the rest of the family. Blessed be the memory of Gloria Brockman. Thank you to everybody who came out last week to our campfire worship. We had a great turnout, wonderful food, and the kids did a super job of leading worship. So hopefully we can maybe do that again sometime before the weather turns on us. Today, there's a Legion breakfast down there, so after worship and after the cookies, you can go have pancakes down at the Legion if you want to. You don't get skinny here in Washington Springs, do you? Next Sunday, we will acknowledge school starting by offering a special backpack blessing. So parents, bring your kiddos in and remind them to bring their backpacks, and we will have a special blessing for our educators as well as our parents and our students who will be starting back to school. Naomi Rebecca Circles will meet tomorrow at 6-ish, they tell me, at the field house. All are welcome. We'll have a little Bible study out there, and it'll be really fun. We're still collecting school supplies for Lutheran World Relief. Please, when you're out and about, remember to pick up a few supplies to help fill them. The quilting ladies have told me they have 30 bags made, and so I was thinking maybe we could have sort of a little contest. Will we have more bags, or will we have more supplies? I bet we can get more bags if we have more supplies. So please, everybody join in. It's great fun. Sunday school will start soon, and we still need one teacher. If you feel God's call on your life to help in this way, please contact Rebecca or just call the church office. Does anybody have any other announcements for the good of the community? No? All right, then, please rise. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Share the peace with your neighbors, please. God's peace to you. 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 Peace be with you. Peace be to you. Oops, excuse me. Peace be with you. Our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. It's in your With One Voice 771 or, of course, on the screens.
Thank you.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who greets us in this and every season, whose word never fails, and whose promise is sure. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. We confess that we have sinned. We have hurt our community. We have squandered your blessings. We have hoarded your bounty. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. Righteous God, we confess that we have sinned. We have failed to be honest. We have lacked the courage to speak. We have spoken falsely. In the name of Jesus, forgive and grant us your mercy. People of God, hear the good news from God. God is a cup of cold water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Claim the gift of God's mercy. You are freed and forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We continue with our opening dialogue. You are the treasured people of the Lord, a people holy to the Lord our God. Keep the words of the Lord in your heart. Teach them to your children. Talk about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise. One does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together the prayer of the day. O God, our defender, storms rage around and within us and cause us to be afraid. Rescue your people from despair. Deliver your sons and daughters from fear and preserve us in the faith of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated and we will hear the lessons.
The first reading comes from Kings chapter 19, verses 9 through 18. At Horeb, Mount of God, Elijah came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant and thrown down your altars and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so strong it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks into pieces before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." The Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. So you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel. You shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, and Abel-Meholah as prophet in your place. Whoever escapes from the sword of Hazael, Jehu shall kill. Whoever escapes from the sword of Jehu, Elisha shall kill. And yet I will leave 7,000 Israel, all the knees that have bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." Word of the Lord. Psalm chapter 85, verses 8 through 13. "I will listen to the Lord, God is saying, for you speak peace and faithful people and those who turn their hearts to you. Steadfast love and faithfulness have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. The Lord will indeed grant prosperity, and our land will yield its increase.
Righteousness shall go before the Lord, and shall prepare for God.
The second reading comes from Romans chapter 10, verses 5 through 15. Moses writes it concerning righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, "Do not say in your heart, 'Who will ascend into heaven?' That is to bring Christ down, or 'Who will descend into the abyss?' That is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart, and that is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For the one who believes with the heart is so justified, and the one who confesses with the mouth is so saved. The scripture says, 'No one who believes in him will be put to shame.' For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one who they have not heard? And how are they to hear with someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, 'How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news.'" The word of the Lord.
Thank you, Nathan. Children, it's time for you to come forward for a little message if you want to. Hey, you were in a hurry, weren't you? Were you in a hurry? Yeah. How are you guys? Good. Are y'all ready for school to start?
Yeah.
You're not in school yet? Maybe next year, huh? Yeah. But everybody else is getting ready? Yeah? Yeah?
Yeah.
Good. Good. Well, this morning I was thinking about something and I was wondering, do you remember a time when you've been afraid? Sometimes little kids are afraid their first day of school, aren't they? Yeah, sometimes they are. Can you think of a time when you've been afraid You scared of anything? One time I got bit by a dog, and I'm a little bit afraid of dogs now. And that's crazy, because I always liked dogs. How about a nightmare? You ever have a bad dream in the middle of the night and you're scared? Yeah, sometimes. We all do that, don't we? Everybody, I think, has had a bad dream in the middle of the night. What do you do when that happens? You wake up and go downstairs? Upstairs. Is that where Mom and Dad are? Yeah. And you have a nightlight. That helps too, doesn't it? When we are scared, it can make all the difference in the world to know that somebody who loves us is close by, right? That's why we go. Knowing that somebody strong is there to protect and to take care of us makes that nightmare disappear, doesn't it? Well, the lesson I'm going to read in a couple minutes, Jesus' best friends were really, really scared. I'm sure you've heard this story in Sunday school, but they were out on a boat and a great big wind came up and they were all alone and they were so afraid they were going to sink and drown. But guess what? What happened then? Do you remember the story? Jesus came walking across the water to save them. Is that not amazing? Jesus can even walk on water to save people. There are many things in our worlds that can make us feel afraid, but one thing we never, ever have to be afraid of is God. God is here to save us. Jesus came walking across the water because he loved his friends, and Jesus will move everything he can to save you too. Sometimes, how do we know that? How do we know that Jesus is on your side and God isn't just there telling you do this and don't do that? Because we are his children. We became his children when we were born, but he gave us his promise that we would always be his children in our baptisms. So if you got wet in your baptism, you got God's promise. It's as simple as that. Isn't that the coolest thing ever? How much easier can it get? So, but the biggest thing is we can't see Jesus, though, can we? I mean, we can know that he's there and he's going to fix things and eventually things will all work out and we'll go to heaven and everybody will be happy ever after. But what about now? Does Jesus show up when you have a bad dream? He kind of does, because he shows up in his people. All these people that you see here in church are God's people. And they are charged with being Jesus to you. When you were baptized, they made promises to look out for you and for your parents. And so you can always trust that they will pray for you and they will do their best to make sure that you are well taken care of. And that's a wonderful thing, isn't it? Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, for choosing us to be yours. And thank you so much for giving us a church who will love and care for us too. Help us to be good to one another and help us to be thankful. And please bless us and everybody in our house this week as we get ready for school. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming up. Please rise now out of respect for the words and works of Jesus our Lord. Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 14th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side of the Sea of Galilee while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It's a ghost," and they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Jesus said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and started walking on the water and came toward Jesus. But when Peter noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Good morning once again, and I am happy as always to bring grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Today's gospel lesson is a story that I'm sure all of you found very familiar, didn't you? It begins right after last week's lesson, that of Jesus' miracle of feeding the great crowd with only 5 loaves and 2 fish. As we enter the story, we see Jesus has sent the disciples on ahead across the Sea of Galilee while he closes the day and then enjoys a few minutes of peace and quiet in prayer alone with his Father. It kind of reminds me a little bit of the political arena that we're seeing already happening in Iowa and other places where advanced teams move out to scout the next engagement while the candidate is finishing up the rally. Presumably, the disciples were the advanced team, assessing what might be necessary for the next day's work. And hopefully, they remembered to buy groceries this time. Now, the Sea of Galilee is not really a sea as we think of a sea, but a huge freshwater lake. It's approximately 33 miles around, with a surface area of 64 square miles. Just to give a little perspective, we in rural America know that 1 square mile equals 640 acres, or a section of land. So the Sea of Galilee has a surface area, covers 64 sections, or about 41,000 acres, with a maximum depth of 141 feet. So we compare that to maybe Lake Ponset, one of South Dakota's largest natural lakes, which has a surface area of 8,000 acres. The Sea of Galilee is like 5 Lake Ponsets put together, only way deeper. Ponset is only 22 feet deep at its deepest. The Sea of Galilee is also the lowest freshwater lake in the world at about 690 feet below sea level. And it's known for harsh storms arriving with little or no warning, which is exactly what happened, isn't it? We know some of the disciples were experienced fishermen, so obviously there hadn't been signs of a storm or they wouldn't have cast off. And this one was a doozy. They were far from land, trying to sail against the wind while huge waves threatened to capsize the boat. They were frightened. Sure, they were going to be washed overboard and drowned. They were bailing frantically when something made them look up. And what did they see? Someone walking to them across the water. That pretty much completed the nightmare, I'm sure. But the ghostly figure atop the waves turned out to be Jesus, their beloved teacher. As he neared them, Jesus called out to his terrified friends, "It's me. Don't be afraid." Now, you'd think There would be an immediate and collective sigh of relief in the boat, and perhaps there was from some, but Peter, oh, Peter, you gotta love him, don't you? Peter doesn't believe his eyes, or apparently his ears either, and wants proof, so he hollers over, "If it is you, Lord, show me. Let me walk on water like you." Jesus humors him, saying, "Okay, then, come on." So Peter hops out of the boat, and lo and behold, he is walking on water. But then he notices he really is walking on water, and the storm is still growing strong. The wind is whipping all around him, and he gets frightened, and so he starts to sink. And so again, Peter calls out to Jesus, only this time there was no doubt. "Save me, Lord," he cries, and Jesus does. Now, many times we hold this story up as an example to show us what faith looks like, don't we? We are told to be like Peter and to step out of the boat, and we will walk blithely through the storms of life in faith, because when we keep our eyes on Jesus, then and only then, we will be safe. And simplistically speaking, this is true. We would save ourselves a lot of grief, if we could keep our eyes on Jesus and trust that he will, no matter what, keep us afloat in the storms of life. But here's the deal. Looking at the story from that angle alone puts all the responsibility on us and pretty much makes Jesus unnecessary. Except, of course, that we need him to hang out to save our fannies if and when we do need him. So let's take a closer look at this story. Let's remind ourselves what the purpose of the Bible is, though. First, to show us God and how God works out of God's great love for God's people. So having that established, we can note two more things. First of all, Jesus knew the disciples were in this horrible storm. He came to them, walking across the water to rescue them. "Calm down," he said. "I'm here. Don't be afraid." Now, that's not the translation you have in your hands, but it's not my own paraphrase either. It's from the God's Word translation. "Calm down. I'm here. Don't be afraid." These words evoke memories of our own childhoods, don't they? Or of raising our own small children and grandchildren. Words all of us have heard and words all of us have said in the middle of a night when a terrified child is having a nightmare. "It's okay. Mommy's got you." Or, "Shh, Daddy's here. Don't be afraid." The child immediately begins to calm down at the sound of a parent's voice. He trusts everything will be okay. She has no need to know anything else. The nightmare is soon forgotten. The child never doubts that reality comes in with that parent, and that when he hears, "I'm here," the nightmare's over. But Peter doubted. "If it is you, Lord, then command me to come to you on the water." Peter was testing, as they say in scientific circles, a hypothesis, using what is a very good process, a conditional statement. If, then, statements are used to prove or disprove theories, are they not? If a number is divisible by 2, then it's an even number. Well, of course. If the gas light comes on in the car, then you better stop and fill up before you leave town. Probably. Depending on how far you mean to go. If there's lightning, there'll be rain. Or not, sometimes. We use conditional statements to assuage our skepticism. And skepticism is alive and well in our world and an important part of education, of science, and of safety, too. Some of us are more skeptical than others, to be sure, which is why we need to learn to ask good questions and to seek out reputable sources for the answers. But as soon as you look at the word skepticism more closely, including its synonym, doubt, cynicism, suspicion, pessimism, and unbelief, to name a few, you clearly see that skepticism does not belong in the same room as faith. What's the opposite of faith? Doubt. You can be and you must be skeptical in this world. We must cast a wide net, take in information from all kinds of different sources, and be willing to take in yet more, because information is always changing and there are a few absolutes in this world. But people, God is absolute. Jesus came to his disciples across the water in the middle of their storm. Peter knew it was Jesus. He hopped out of the boat after all. What Peter doubted was that Jesus could handle the storm. Which brings us to the second part. There is no good news, no gospel in saying that if I keep my eyes on Jesus, I won't sink. That's only do good, be good, get good, and we all know that doesn't work. As Paul writes, that is the righteousness of Moses. That is the justice of this world and of the laws that make this world an orderly place to live in. If we could not take our eyes off Jesus, if we could always know the mind of God and obey, we wouldn't need saving. Jesus' life and death then would have been in vain. It would have been an utter waste of God's time. But it wasn't, because we can't. Our righteousness, our status before God, our faith, doesn't come from our obedience. We are not the subject of the gospel. God is. We are the object. God's grace is never dependent upon us. As we learned before, the seed doesn't decide when to grow. The rain doesn't choose where to fall. God does what God wants done. Our world today is highly charged, fraught with information and misinformation, threatening to keep us all in a state of anxiety. But one thing we never, ever have to worry about is whether or not God is in charge. He is, he was, he has always been, and he promises he always will be. Now, Peter got the if-then that he was asking for, but he still doubted. And he doubted himself, too. He listened to the storm, and he questioned his ability to fulfill Jesus' call to him. Don't we do that all the time? I do, anyway. I think, what on earth every Sunday morning am I doing here in this pulpit? I'm a lot of things, but this is definitely out of the boat for me. But God called me in my baptism to serve God's people, and this is where God put me. He's also called you to serve. The voices of this world, those loud voices telling us we're not trying hard enough, or we're not good enough, or we're wrong, or we have to do more, or maybe that we're sinking, those voices don't speak for God. God is the still small voice from the first lesson saying, I am. And because I am, you can. So chill. Take my hand. I'm here. You can do this. Don't be afraid. Jesus came not to prove God's existence or to prove God's power, but to prove God's love and to deliver that love in forgiveness, even while dying, so that we can know that while we are still in our sin, even while we're still in the storm, he is with us. God is not about you. God is in you, for you, with you. This is the faith that he has put on your lips and in your heart, that Christ Jesus is Lord. So yeah, the world is a mess sometimes, isn't it? It's full of wind and noise, filling us with all kinds of fear. But people of God, Jesus can handle the storm, and so can you. You are blood-bought sons and daughters of the King of Kings and of the Lord of Lords. So get out there this week and walk on some water. Amen. Please rise as you are able for our hymn of the day. Precious Lord, take my hand. In Christ, you have heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. We believe in him and are marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we continue our worship with the offering. Children's offering.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God, our Creator, you open wide your hand and satisfy the desire of every living creature. With these gifts, we bless you for your tender nurture and care. Help us to delight in your will and walk in your ways. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Trusting in God's abundant mercy, let us offer our prayers for a world in need. God of grace and faith, your faithfulness is never ending and your righteousness becomes ours through Christ Jesus. Send the church to proclaim the gospel both near and far, in church buildings and on street corners, in person and through digital means. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of sky and sea, the plants, animals, mountains, and plains proclaim your glory. Prosper our work as we care for your world. Bring relief to areas recovering from natural disasters, especially the people on the island of Maui as they rebuild their lives after the horrible fire. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of peace and justice, you call us to live as your beloved community throughout the world. Instill in local, regional, national, and global political and civic leaders a desire for truth and a desire to work for the well-being of all people. We pray for our president, Joe Biden, our governor, Kristi Noem, and all those who serve us as our representatives. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of care and compassion, you bring assurance when we are afraid. Bring calm to any who are anxious or fearful. Bless the work of therapists, nurses, doctors, and other health care providers. Comfort all who grieve and soothe any who are sick, especially Bob, Tori, LaVon, Jade, Steve, Homer, Karen, Valerie, Wanda, Tim, Larry, Jacob, Adeline, Pauline, Sue, Betty, and those we name silently before you in our own hearts. Grant that they may await healing and deliverance in the firm conviction that nothing can separate them from your love in Christ Jesus. Hear us, O God. God of wonder, you accompany us in both joys and sorrows. We pray for children and teachers preparing for a new school year. Make your presence known in their work and in our play, in lively conversation and in quiet rest. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray in the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now, people of God, receive God's blessing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now, always, and forever. Amen. Our sending hymn, My Life Flows On in Endless Song, number 781. Go in peace, serve the Lord.